Hi Lee, how are you?
I'm okay. I've just moved to speaker mode as well. Yeah, good. I watched the Andromeda Strain earlier.
Yeah, what'd you
No, I
think of
didn't.
it?
No, I mean I've read the book, so I know it. I didn't realize it was based in Arizona though.
I know it's near where I live, and everybody dies. It was
So you
very
know.
lovely. Yeah.
And then I saw David Krakauer saying, 20 miles from here. It's like, okay.
Yeah.
But no, I'm
Yeah.
fine.
I don't know. Kate and I had a whole conversation about trying to seed origin life on other worlds. And I guess I wanted to kind of get your opinion on that because I know you've thought about it a lot. And then I realized sort of after the conversation that people might misinterpret it as kind of trying to be very colonial and that like Earth should try to go and take over other planets. But I think there's kind of more of an academic interest in just understanding what life is and that seeding life on another world really understand it.
Yeah, I mean, my opinion is that we are very Earth-centric, and I think thinking about even the idea that complex life can't occur elsewhere, I think is wrong. We just simply don't know. So I have my thoughts on how easy it is to get life, and then how difficult it is to get complex life and intelligent life. I think actually Earth was a pretty poor place for complex life to emerge quickly. I don't think that's a characteristic of complex, sorry, intelligent life. I think that we simply don't know, and I can give you some thoughts on that.
Yeah, well, I'm really curious now. Why do you think Earth is a bad place?
Because it had to switch metabolism. If I think about this, right? So the first cells, so you went through this kind of single cell all the way to eukaryotes, then multicellularity into biology. Well, the production of oxygen and the switch over in photosynthesis was needed so things could move around. And I think to have real control over your body like a robot would now, required on Earth more energy. So it had to switch metabolism. So that switching metabolism for co required cognition. But if the gravitational constant on Earth or the force of gravity was different on Earth and the materials available and the density was different, we might not have needed to switch metabolism. Therefore, we might got to intelligence much more quickly.
So do you think you need a smaller planet or a larger planet to get there
I
faster?
don't know. I'm not a planetary scientist. I guess maybe you would need a less dense planet, or maybe the atmospheric pressure could be different. Because one bar is quite a lot. We just take it for granted. One bar is quite a lot of pressure. So I'm just wondering if the narrow region of energy, which we had to get to intelligent life on Earth, had been different, then maybe we would have been basically solving general relativity 2 billion years ago. And that
Yeah.
was my new idea for the week.
Okay. I'm not sure I agree with it, but it is sufficiently provocative to be interesting.
Why don't you agree?
I don't know that I disagree. I'm not sure I know how to think about it. I mean, there's always this issue with thinking about the history of life on Earth that there's like a single example, so it's really hard to reason about any of these particular events that happen because it's very anecdotal. And so
I mean, I guess all I'm saying is that for me, it seems that intelligence requires some kind of movement in the environment, controlled movement, not kind of biased Brownian motion like a flagella on a bacteria. And I was playing around with the idea of why make the assumption that intelligent life took this, is there's a bottleneck on Earth? We simply don't know. So I think I would agree with you, but I would just like to kind of find reasons why we might not need 2 billion years to get to intelligence. It could be almost as instantaneous, or not instantaneous, maybe just another 100 million years rather than, because I mean, 200 million years for life, 100 million years for intelligence. Just imagine what our technology would be like now if we had an extra 2 billion years.
But you're also making a distinction between life and intelligence. Do you really think they're different, or do you think intelligence is just kind of like on a continuum with whatever we call life?
I think I'd agree with on the continuum, but we're really way up. So I would say that biology has some kind of control over information, but I think the emergence of abstraction in us, in animals, in mammals in particular, and humans, represented another kick in our ability. So if if the difference between life and non-life is the ability to do complex things and evolve and undergo selection, then you're then able to go select, produce an ecosystem, and then get to them creatures that can move around, start to use tools. That tool making process ultimately led to abstraction. That abstraction led to us being able to develop technology. And that then is kind of at the end of the continuum, but really far away.
So I think you're hitting on something that I think is quite difficult. I always get these questions about, you know, it's easy to describe things in terms of these kind of abstract or informational properties, like, you know, like you were using the example of Einstein inventing relativity or something, but it's really difficult to prove that that's actually what's happening and not just a narrative. I mean, how would you prove what you're saying, that there's actually a spectrum and a continuum of processes? What would be the experiment or theory?
What, for life, you mean intelligence?
Yeah.
I mean, I think there's lots of ways we could do it more formally, but they all get stuck because we end up defining life. And yeah. So I think in that regard, I really agree with, well, maybe we should explain why I agree with you, but that there's many missing layers. So really defining life is just a fruitless enterprise because we get wrapped up with the semantics and you don't know what experiment you can do. So I guess the experiment to do is to try and somehow measure objectively, if that's possible, the amount of uncertainty you have associated with a given trajectory. So I think that's actually, we can take the US political election as probably one good example.
Excellent.
Or how much certainty there is. I think one interesting thing about life is that life is able to do very uncertain things, if that flows it on in. So you can really get to the edge of state space. So let's not talk about politics. Let's talk about the invention of the iPhone or an invention of a piece of artwork. If you retrace those lineages, it's unlikely that we go back in time. If we were able to do a Superman and turn the Earth backwards and then Steve Jobs was to make the iPhone again, it would be slightly different, but almost the same. And so I think, so you want objects that have contingent information in them. And when you see those processes playing out, there's lots of uncertainty in where the trajectory will be. But once you're there, you can tell the difference between that thing and the background, if that makes sense. So really you want to treat, and that's maybe another way of looking at this as objectively as possible by counting the number of bits. So you want a load of bits that you know are not random, but then also you want processes that are producing these bit collections that are very different to one another. Then you know that you're onto something that's important. I don't even know if I've answered your question, I'm sorry, but.
No, it's all right. So it sounds like you're saying, like, the way that you're thinking about quantifying life or intelligence is basically given some components that those systems might start from or be built from, how unpredictable is the outcome that you get given those starting
materials? It's like a Turing test, I would say, the best way of looking at it, or the Voidcom, is it Voidcom they call it in a Blade Runner? It's like, how many questions did you have to ask to check you're not a replicant? And so, and that's because of, if you're looking at a chatbot, how smart do you have to make your chatbot to convince the chatbot that it's, convince the user on the other side that they're not it's not a chatbot. But you know what I mean?
Are you a chatbot?
I might be.
I think
by my incoherence in this discussion, I think I could be a very poor chatbot.
Yeah. I mean, these questions are really tough, so it's hard stuff. And just, I don't know, like, I guess one question I always have is sort of like what, which is related to my last question, but like, what's going to be the convincing case that one can make? So like in the origin of life, for example, I was really frustrated with the field when I first got into it, because the sort of standard in origin of life was making some things that are part of a living system, but it might just be like a couple small molecules, not even like a big molecule. And so it's not even anywhere close to, you know, having a non-living system transition into being a living system. And then on the other side of it, you know, you have people kind of trying to reconstruct the history of life, and they get back to something called the last universal common ancestor, which is, you know, still a very complex cellular machinery that might have existed on early Earth. And there's like this huge gap in between that people aren't really seeming to address very effectively directly. Mm-hmm. And it leaves me with sort of this question about like, what's the standard of evidence and how are we actually going to be able to assess this gap and actually do science that's going to address it. And you seem to be one of the people that's really tackling that head on. So I thought maybe you could talk a little bit about that and explain more to me.
Okay. Well, I mean, I agree that there is a big problem because we are, but we're kind of being a victim to the history books. But I'll throw one thing out, which, and then I'll go and answer your question. I think we have to throw away the LUCA model. I don't think there was a last universal common ancestor.
Yeah, sure.
I mean, I think that's pretty obvious. You don't really need much shelling on that. But I think what's interesting is that what is it about Earth that took all the pre-LUCAs and converted them to LUCA? So I think that I'm just completely contradicting myself from before saying these trajectories, but I think maybe to start with, you've got this chemistry that becomes living or on the cusp of living and doing its thing and undergoing selection. And there is basically a decision that gets made. Everyone says, oh, you know what? We're just going to adopt the same molecular language because we can more efficiently evolve. And then suddenly there's a transition to what is then competently LUCA. And that may have taken a very long time. And then LUCA, once it was established and everyone agreed on the standard, everyone then went off. And then basically ecosystems got developed. So I would say pre-LUCA on Earth, there was a chemical prebiotic, primordial, pre-biological ecosystem in which small biologies were arriving. And then the only way they could then get above a certain bottleneck in selection was to adopt LUCA. And it was a very slow process.
Do you think they were actually biology at that stage? Yes. Or do you think it was just on a trajectory that was heading toward life?
Genes and everything. I think they had different genes. It's like some of them might have had 10 different base pairs. Some might have had 40 amino acids. And they just realized that was very chaotic and inefficient. And there was just a pruning process going on. Mm-hmm. And I think there was a battle between what was evolvable and what was maintainable, selectable, maintainable. But coming back to your question, how do we measure it? So my kind of impression right now, my intuition is that I'm coming at you as a chemist, and I think about molecules. So I tend to think about how likely is it when I see a molecule in my laboratory, detect a new molecule, is it that molecule could have arisen by chance? And using that kind of thought process and counting how much chance is required, how many coin flips will be needed to make that molecule, I can put that on the scale of likelihood to have risen by chance or needed some kind of machinery like biology. Because what I've also observed, that's the other half of this equation, is that biology can make the most complex molecules known. In fact, there seems to be a hard threshold which random chance can't get through unless you have a genetic system. And that's the thing I'm playing with right now. People have a really hard time getting through that threshold. So I say, okay, don't worry about that. Just imagine you go to Mars and you find a Tesla on Mars. You would say that was proof of Elon Musk or the Tesla being on Mars, right? So then you go down and say, what is the most complex molecule you expect to find elsewhere? You can be absolutely sure that that's a life form, that's a proxy for life, and the life form produced it. That's where I'm coming from, because I can then do an experiment, a chemical experiment, to quantify that.
Yeah. So I've always really liked this proposal, as you know, like as a way of measuring biosignatures. And I think it also has some interesting things to say about what physics is underlying life, but you've it's sort of like cleverly skirts the issue in some sense of like what kind of system is necessary to cross the threshold. And so I'm just curious if you've been thinking about that at all and how you would possibly design a system or design an experiment that would allow you to go from sort of this non-living region where life, or you don't need life to assemble the objects, and then to this one where you need life to assemble it. Clearly there has to be some transition there in the kind of processes that are happening. Mm-hmm. But I think that's one of the hardest questions in any of it, is to try to figure out what that is.
Yeah. I think framing it properly. So I've begun to, just in the past day or so, start to frame it a bit more simply, because what I want to say is that actually there's nothing secret, well, there is new physics, and there is a, well, there is a new way of looking at physics that the physicists aren't ready for because of some cultural aspects of the way that physicists think of looking at the world. But let's put that to one side, because I think that would cause more conceptual problems than it solves. So I want to start from a chemical experiment and say, right, if I've got a soup, a soup of random molecules in the environment, what I want to do is say, if the molecules, let's say the reactions in the molecules, sorry, the reaction in the soup is more active than the reaction in the surroundings. So that things are changing faster in the bowl of soup than in the cauldron around the soup, right? So that's good. So then you've got these reactions occurring. You say, right, now what, let's just say my cauldron has features in it, scratches, defects, chance places where contaminants are kept. Can those, could the identity of a cauldron print itself into the chemistry by controlling the chemistry over time? And that's what we're showing in my lab, in that actually it's, although it's random, the defects are random, the cauldron's identity is non-random, right? It's not, after that, the processes that gave rise to the cauldron was random, but the cauldron's identity is non-random with respect to the chemistry going on. And I only really crystallized this morning. So what do I mean? Random processes make the clay that makes a cauldron. Great, we have the clay. The time scale for that clay is longer for the what turnover. Then the chemistry going on in that cauldron is much, much faster than the chemistry made the cauldron. So you're just two different time scales. So what that can do is influence the chemistry, and that random chemistry can be guided by the cauldron. And at some point you start to get selection. So the process of the cauldron and the chemistry working together produces molecules that could not be accessed from the soup on its own without the cauldron. Mm-hmm. So that then feeds back in a loop over time, and only over time does selection emerge. So what I think happens is that selection predates LUCA evolution.
Right. I mean, there's a really tough question here, which is like, where does the randomness itself come from? Because you always need this sort of these random events for selection to operate on.
No, that's fine. That's fine. Sorry, I'll let you finish.
No, it's all right. Go ahead.
So what I mean is, you allowed random, so population of random is a fine, but only when the random, so it's about identity. So if there's a chance happening, so it's about the volume of stuff that gets trapped in the chemistry. Mm-hmm. As long as that volume of stuff maintains some relationship with the chemistry, although it's random, it directs the chemistry to be non-random. It's like counterintuitive, but it isn't, because it's two different timescales. What you've got to do is just accept, it's a bit like if I take two minerals, let's just say I take a lump of mineral and I hit it with a hammer, and I'm able to precisely break it into two. Identical mineral, identical number of atoms, but if I look at each mineral face, they'd have different scratches. So now I can immediately call one mineral slice Sarah, and I'll call one Lee, or whatever, or Bob and Jim, right? You know, whatever, you give them names, whatever names are, because they are different, because they have different aspects associated with them. So then if I take those two minerals and put them in different chemistries, even though they're compositionally identical, those random defects over time will steer the chemistry to, and you'll get different populations of molecules. And that is selection. Now, that's because now the process that's going on is non-random. You're not changing the defects randomly. Mm-hmm. So there's some reliability, but the process of creating that information was random, because information doesn't exist. It only gets created in the future when that random ensemble promotes survival of the chemistry, and that survival of the chemistry gets fed back into the environment again.
Yeah, I mean, this is always one of sort of the odd features of information when we talk about it this way, is that it's not a conserved property. And so somehow evolution is creating it. And so you've just given a mechanism where that's by selection in the future. But it's like, I mean, it's easy to say these things, but they're oddly not intuitive. At least not from like the way we think about physics right now, which I think was part of your point, that it's not really able to be described by the way that we understand things right now.
Yeah, I mean, what I was delicately trying to say earlier is that the conservation information physics is not actually true in the universe.
Yeah.
And this is kind of a bit of a deep problem, because you've got all the quantum gravity people going, yeah, we're going to conserve information at a black hole and use this to control how we do quantum gravity at black holes. But actually, for life to emerge, conservation of information in the universe cannot be true. And the only reason why we're trying to conserve information at a black hole is because our notion of the second law and the way the universe started. Because we don't know how the universe started and where the order came from, and we haven't got any proof for the second law and all the vast statistical proof, we're kind of, and we don't know how life started, we're kind of stuck between these three really important, almost immovable, not facts, but really important pillars of how we understand our universe, which is kind of cool because one of them has to break.
Yeah. I mean, the problem I always have is sort of like the fine tuning of the initial condition of the universe. You know, because I've had a couple conversations with people where, you know, I might talk about like, you know, how the universe produced my coffee cup, and they'll say, well, it was because of some minor fluctuation in the initial state of the universe, and they can calculate the likelihood of that fluctuation or something by retrodicting the laws back in time. But that's going from our state now and trying to predict the past, not taking any kind of, you know, sort of first principles assumption about what the initial state needed to be to produce a cup. And I don't think that that problem is actually solvable.
Well, I think you're putting it really nicely, because I think what you're saying is that the understanding the physics of the transition to life, in a way, is going to help us rewrite our entire model of the universe. Because it's not consistent.
Yeah, I agree with that. I mean, I think there's kind of this interesting thing, because people think quantum mechanics is so weird because it gives you sort of multiple histories and, you know, like people like to talk about the multiverse and stuff. But I think biological systems have this kind of also inherent multiple histories. It's, you can't predict the future of a biological system very accurately, and you can't predict the past either, because there's too many possible histories converging on a particular state and too many possible futures emanating from a particular state. And it seems to require a completely different kind of dynamical system than this kind of idea that we have in physics of a particular initial state and some deterministic law that never changes in time and tells you all the future states you'll ever have with potentially infinite precision, which is too much information for the universe to actually deal with.
I mean, I've had many philosophical conversations about this with physicists. And I think what I try to turn back to at the moment is, although I'd love to have those conversations, I think probably I would be seen as being relatively ill-qualified, although maybe my lack of qualifications might uniquely qualify me for asking this stupid question with some authority. But I think what I have to do, or what I'm trying to do, is we're making experimental measurements in the lab now where we can actually see, in the lab, what we're doing to look at this is we're generating primordial soups and looking at the combinatorial explosion in chemistry. We're taking biology and looking at the diversity of molecules. And then we found a way of counting the complexity of those objects and bringing them together. And the thing that we've just noticed in the last few weeks is that there's not a smooth transition. There seems to be a gap. And that gap, I think, is really telling us something very interesting about the way that life emerged, the universe and physics, chemistry and biology. So it's pretty profound. From that point of view, or it could be that I can't make a measurement properly and there's a blind spot, which is probably the most likely explanation, but let's entertain all possibilities.
No, I mean, I agree with you about the gap, but I think it's really interesting because a lot of times when I talk about there being new physics necessary to explain life, people think I'm taking like this tremendous leap and, oh my God, why do you need to go there? Our current physics works so well. And I think about like people in the 1800s, you know, physicists thought physics was complete and there was nothing new to discover. And certainly we knew classical mechanics, we would never have like necessarily predicted quantum mechanics would have come along. So I think this idea that life doesn't hold new principles and that there's nothing to be learned by chemical or biological organization is really premature, and that we should be looking for the kind of features that you're describing or things that are anomalous and, you know, need explanation in life. And so I think for me, when I'm thinking about trying to construct a theory for life, I'm always thinking about what are the things that cannot be explained by current physics or would be so convoluted or sufficiently impractical to explain that this suggests there's actually a gap in our knowledge.
And I agree. I mean, I agree, but what you say to a physicist is what is a physicist? So a physicist wants to understand how the universe works. Mm-hmm. So what physicists would say, right, I can write down all the equations that describe the universe. I'm just going to go to my pet universe and my fake universe and do it. And go on then, make life. And they're like, no, I've got some galaxies and all the really interesting stuff that human beings have had to invent through life, you know, basically quantum effects, quantum confinement, quantum computers, through technology, would not exist in the physicist universe because none of that would emerge. So I think physicists have to deal with this problem. Then you have to get to the chemists, where the chemists are trapped because the poor chemist is not really a discrete science anymore. The chemist is kind of in service of the physicist and the biologist, and we're not allowed to ask profound questions. So that's why a lot of chemists, when they try and go profound, go to the origin of life history lesson. And that kind of you get people stuck in the loop there. So I think it is fascinating. I agree with you. I think that physicists who want to actually own the badge need to deal with this problem. No card-carrying physicist can ignore this problem anymore.
Yeah, I don't think so. But I was just thinking that maybe we should just go back to natural philosophers. And if people want to ask deep questions, they should have a different name, because the deepest questions don't have disciplinary boundaries. They're just questions.
Let's go to a world where, let's say we, I like the physicist, I like where you went with the physicist, because you take some, let's just take some Brownian objects and give them to a physicist. They can law of Brownian motion, explain. Now take some bacteria and give them to a physicist and say, explain it. And you're allowed to, and the physicist doesn't know that life exists. I mean, in a mechanical sense, right? Physicists really like, there's a ghost in these bacteria, there's a ghost in these particles.
I think actually the problems, they might say that, but I think the problem's actually harder than that, because the thing that life does that's really interesting is it seems to harness the laws of physics, right? So every scale living processes operate on, they can look a lot like physics, and they can be modeled by the traditional tools of physics, but physics can't explain the origin or the reemergence of all these hierarchies or how they evolve in time. So what I mean by that is, like, there's a lot of really good, like, simple physics models for collective behavior, for example. But it always struck me as very odd that we can build these models for intelligent quote-unquote agents, like a bacterial cell or a human crowd, and we can model them with the same kind of thing, like, you know, the same kind of models that we might use for Brownian motion or other collective effects in, you know, in inanimate materials. And I don't know if there's something interesting there, but just the fact that these simple tools seem to work, I think, makes people kind of overconfident in their ability and explanatory power.
I was having an argument with a kind of intern the other day, who was basically trying to tell me how the math is the universe, or the model is the universe, or was explaining it that way. And I kept pulling them back and said, look, there is reality and there's your model of reality, and they're not the same. And what I think the problem is with a lot of the way physicists work or train now is that people merge those together, and so they don't really see the disconnect. And I think that's one thing that has to be got over, is maybe a teaching and cultural thing. But what you're saying about the way that things look, right, I think is really important, and where the observer role is. And words like information are used in physics a lot, but the universe, I keep saying, universe without life is a universe without information, because information has a special quality given it causally by living systems. And I can't seem to get through to physicists when I talk to them, say that information is not data, it's not just correlations, unless there's an encoding and decoding effect. Because if information was just correlations, then you wouldn't actually need to record the information. You would just, because you knew all the physics in your head, you'd be like, yeah, I know that's going to happen. I don't need to have any more information, I don't know if I'm making it, maybe I'm just incoherent now, but there's something special about information that physicists ignore. And that's where I think the new understanding between the disciplines of chemistry and physics will allow us to literally invent biology.
Yeah. Yeah, no, I think I'm in total agreement with what you're saying. I mean, I guess, so part of the hard thing that we're, like, circling around right now is that And I think this is the way that people usually state it. It's kind of like, because life doesn't violate any known laws of physics and chemistry, it seems like you don't need additional principles. But what life is doing is actually kind of manipulating known laws of physics and chemistry by using information to actually control what processes are happening. So so things like chemotaxis or gravitaxis, or you know, the kind of Brownian motion of bacteria we were just describing, or you know, the fact that we can, I don't know, understand the laws of gravitation, are all kind of consistent with the laws of physics, but they don't emerge naturally from it. And it's almost like, it's like you need the laws that operate in the universe, and then you need physical systems to tell you which processes can happen within the constraints of what processes are possible. And that's effectively what biological systems are doing, because they have information encoded in the objects they are. They actually determine what processes can happen within the constraints of the laws, or at least that's how I think about it. So I don't think that it's incompatible. I just think it's not sufficient to really explain what's going on. And yeah, it's sort of like I have this, you know, you've probably seen me give talks where I've used this quote, but I have this favorite quote from David Deutsch, which is, metals can be transmuted to gold in the processes that power stars, and by intelligent beings that understand those processes, and by nothing else in the universe. And I think physics gets the first one really well, but not the second at all. And that's really sort of like what we're asking for explanation of, is like, why is it that there are these physical systems that emerge in the universe that seem to have this additional capacity to make transformations that aren't necessarily hard coded into the initial state or the set of configuration of objects that you have. And that's what we mean when we say they create information, because they enable things that require them to be in the system to specify that that future is even possible.
Yeah. Well, what I'm getting at a bit is, what constitutes a physical law? I mean, I'm way out of my depth here, so there might be some physicists basically...
I think we're all out of our depth, but I mean, we're questioning 400 years of the way people have done physics, so I think that's fine, but...
If you take this kind of, this whole path integral thing, right, you play it to kind of a field theory or to quantum gravity or whatever, just to say, look, or not, let's take something simple. What is a law in physics, right? So let's take the law of gravitation or law of electromagnetism. You say, well, I'm going to write down this law, and I know that there is, you know, proportional inverse square law, blah, 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 between these, you know, these objects, and give you this force. You're like, but why? Why is it a law? Why does that thing work here and over the other side of the universe? They're not connected. Well, it must be that the memory of the universe, the states available, matter expresses this behavior, right? There's constraints. And those constraints, the memory of those constraints is encrypted, encoded, or explicitly described within the standard model. So that means within the standard model and all the standard equations of physics, you have a certain amount of constraints that are specified, and you can't go out with those. And that is a law. Now, here's the interesting physics bit, add on hyperphysics. If you can say, oh, you know what? I now have an extra bit of memory that you don't get in that over there in that part of the universe. So I can start to diverge trajectory-wise, and you can't do it because you have less memory than me, suddenly you get biology. And I think that's where we have to understand what's going wrong, not going wrong in physics, but observationally. And I think that for me, my obsession is the universe, matter gives certain regions of the universe or memory that other bits don't have. And the ability to select on those memories gives us biology over time. And actually that memory exists in physics and produces laws, but when you get divergence, those laws are no longer laws. It's just a mess until there's some reinforcement. So I think if I ask the physicist to say, tell me how your laws work, and why should a law work here, there, and everywhere? I mean, the tax rate's not the same over the world, so why the tax rate can be different, why can't the law of electromagnetism be different? And I want someone to tell me that doesn't use kind of, you know, some kind of wormhole, spooky action at a difference.
Well, usually I think that the canonical assumption is that, like, if you want to explain that feature, is to appeal to multiverse models and just say, well, they can be different somewhere in the multiverse, but they happen to be what they are in our universe.
But no, exactly.
Yeah, I know. Yeah.
I mean, if I go to the moon and I find that, you know, that the charge on electron is different, what's going on?
Right.
Why can't it be? Well, of course, because that's not allowed. So what that means in our universe, the minimum, you know, the obviously the constants that are that come with this universe given to us by the Big Bang have a certain variation, a certain distribution that is concretely allowed. And that, you know, there's no more memory for that. That's just it. That's just how quantum mechanics and string theory and whatever your chosen theory is works. But biology cheats because it finds other states, and it needs to do that through chemical bonds. Chemical bonds gives access to memories and access to selection, which you're right, harness the available laws of physics, but supercharge them in some way. I don't know if I'm really going off on a bender here, but you know what I mean.
I agree with you. I think the way that I would describe it is the laws of physics, at least as we've written them down, can tell us what can happen, but they don't tell us what does happen for the exact reasons that you're describing.
Yeah,
that
yeah, that's there are, awesome,
yeah, there's objects that emerge that like in chemistry, you do have these random effects, and what structures exist matter to what happens in those systems. And so, I mean, this is the very notion of catalysis. Like if you have a catalyst to catalyze a certain process, it's a very different kind of dynamic than if you didn't have that catalyst present in the system. And so, so this is something that I think is very counterintuitive and goes back to like the Newtonian legacy, right? So I was talking about the fact that physicists like to think about like the initial state and fixed laws of motion. And part of the reason for that is just because that's how Newton wrote down his laws of physics when he was like, you know, the first real person to write down laws in a concrete way. And people have just kind of always assumed that the laws are immutable. But when you get to these path dependent type features that we get when you get to chemistry and biology, it's like the laws that describe those systems are not fixed in time. You have the constraints that the laws of physics permit, but it permits a whole set of, you know, trajectories that are all possible. And what actually happens depends on the objects that are there.
That's a nice way to put it.
My cup here or here, and that depends on something intrinsic to me, not something necessarily the state of the universe.
I think that really concretely gets a very interesting topic about what life is. So let's just go back a bit. What I think we've said is that people like to be physicists because they want to predict what's going to happen in the universe given certain things. So simple objects, you can predict the laws of physics. Now take this process which is a path dependent. You can no longer predict those, but you can kind of make a portrait of them and maybe put in an order parameter. But because you can't predict them precisely, we've kind of taken some wrong turns in that process. So I think what we need to do as scientists is start to understand that we need to bring back the requirement for predictability, but also understanding how the trajectories work, and also accepting there are certain things when the number of steps on your path becomes arbitrarily big, it's impossible to predict, not because you don't have enough information, just because there's a creation of other processes happening. Is this all going on all the time? So I think that's really interesting. And I think that's maybe the way to kind of that we should engage people further to think about this more concretely about what do we measure? You know, you go and measure two hurricanes, they're not alive, they're different. Actual memory, the actual laws that give rise to a hurricane presumably are something like the density, the changing density in the atmosphere, the amount of flux going through it, amount of water vapor, you know, rotational speeds. And so you only need a very small number of constraints to produce a thing called a hurricane, but actually the hurricane's precise identity you cannot record unless you actually go and video it or take it in real time. But you can model the emergence of the hurricane simply with knowing those things. And I think the thing that biology does is physicists coarse grain to do it. And the other big error that we're taking is that when we coarse grain in our models, we ignore the fact that biology does not coarse grain. Biology actually needs the microstates to be concretely built on. And that's another thing that we need to perhaps wrestle with.
Well, I think biological systems do coarse grain, but only in the sense that we do that to build models, not necessarily that that's a real feature.
That's a lovely way of looking at it. Maybe. I mean, all I'm trying to say is that genetic information down at the molecular level does act up at the macro scale.
Yeah.
But it doesn't act by averaging.
No, it definitely doesn't. I mean,
that's the problem, right? Because all the statisticians out there, the StatMech people, are averaging. And I realized this when I was looking at replication. When I talked to physicists about replication, they would just replicate the macrostates. Mm-hmm. If you said, oh, yeah, I'm going to replicate a cell, I'll just replicate the macrostate, you'd have two different species of cell. They were like, that's not the same cell. It's like, oh, it's kind of round. It's got some DNA in it. It's, you know, I copied it. And it's like, that's not a copy.
I mean, just to go back to the beginning of the conversation, I think a really good example of how the microscale impacts the macroscale is just to say that, like, small random mutations in DNA over time led to the event of photosynthesis and oxygenation of our atmosphere. So there is this really strong coupling between what's happening at the level of individual random mutations in DNA or other molecules in biology and what's happening in planetary biogeochemical cycling. So
that's a lovely way to put it. I have to steal that one from you. So what you basically said is that random mutations that are basically quantum mechanically defined allow a planet to get terraformed. Yeah, that's really, that, I like that. That's cool.
I mean, that is what life is a planetary scale process, is a really tight coupling between things that happen at a planetary scale and things that happen at a molecular scale in a really interesting way. As far as having this path dependence that we were talking about. I mean, there's lots of interesting stuff. I guess I think I want, like, one last question, which is kind of a hard one. But I think it was just after, like, the name of the series of talks, I was just kind of wondering about, like, I have sort of a motivation in the way I think about, like, the physics of life to try to, like, make it as interesting as possible for humans, in the sense that I don't really, this is, like, kind of a personal perspective, but I don't really like, I guess I don't really like the narrative that, like, being trained as a physicist, that physics has painted for, like, the significance of, like, humanity in the universe, right? So not specifically humanity, but intelligence or any kind of physical system like us. So I always have this kind of idea in my mind that the physics of life is kind of a really special kind of physics and has some meaning associated with it. But the question of meaning is really a difficult one. So I guess my question is, like, what do you think the meaning of life is, and, like, why it exists? Or is that not really a scientific question and you wouldn't really tackle that from the way that you think about theories of life or experiments about what life is?
That's a very hard question to live. What is the meaning of life?
Yeah.
I think that the emergence of life is just as natural as the creation of galaxies and the turning on of a sun. Mm-hmm. So in that case, would it be simple to say, what is the purpose of the sun? Well, the purpose of the sun is to just cook through all the nuclear fuel that's gathered. Yes. So in that regard, I would say if life has a purpose from that context, it is to use evolution to create as much contingency and complexity as possible. Mm-hmm. And so the future of humanity or the future of life on Earth is incredibly embedded cooperation, robustness between systems and subsystems, and I think that that really it's a competition to see how many levels can we create. So yeah. the meaning of life, I think, in that point of view, is how much resource do we have left in the universe, and how many levels can we make in the time left, perhaps.
Yeah, I guess my view is kind of similar. It's like life is sort of the creative part of the universe. So my view is, life is the way that the universe makes the most things that could exist actually exist. That's, it's just the process of creation of a lot of cool stuff.
So that's why I find people talking about artificial intelligence and life and copying and intelligence, they seem to miss the point and say, no, the artificial intelligence is just a mathematical trick. Right. Be really creative and I'll be excited. Or create me an AI that's creative, that's cool, but you still created it. And I think that people kind of don't understand, because they separate the AI from themselves.
Right.
I mean, the only way I might be able to, you know, do some really cool chemistry one day is by creating AI that does the chemistry for me. And everyone says, the AI created the chemistry, and so I created the AI, right?
Right, it's part of your lineage.
That causal chain that chemists don't understand.
Right. Well, I also think this is like part of the issue with like simulation arguments and things too. I just really think the universe actually exists and warrants a better explanation than we've given it so far. But that's just me.
I mean, it could be that it just is, right? That meaning, you know, if a universe can create complexity, it's like it just is. Like there is no meaning to fusion. It just happens. And so I think what it is the meaning that for us, culturally, we have created meaning to help us sustain ourselves, to select, to maybe, you know, cooperate, to do whatever we want to do in our ecosystems, to keep it in some kind of sustainable state. So maybe, I mean, I don't know, meaning from that point of view is embedded in the relation, in the meaning only has meaning if there are people around you and living systems around you. DNA only has meaning to other things that can process the DNA. Otherwise, it has no meaning.
But this is what you meant when you said it was a cooperative phenomena. Yeah. Sorry. Yeah. Okay. Cool. Yeah. I think
I was going to be asked about the meaning of life today, but...
What?
I didn't think I was going to be asked about the meaning of life today.
I was supposed to ask you some hard questions, wasn't I? Wasn't that my job? I don't remember. But anyway.
I think you did a good job, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway, it was really fun. Thanks so much, Lee. I had a lot of fun. All right.
Are we done now?
Caitlin will reappear in a minute. She might even use it.